Wow, we have so much to talk about when it comes to Netflix's The Umbrella Academy. I have a copious amount of notes. Well, I usually have a lot of notes, but they're super detailed today. So please bear with me. Although I have to say, this is the kind of content from Netflix that makes people feel it's worth that, not only worth that monthly fee, but it can be, for many people, their only the paid source of entertainment, right? A space that Disney and Warner Brothers and Universal are hoping to muscle in on. But I don't know, Netflix certainly has a head start. If you're into this kind of thing, which we're going to discuss, because not everybody loves The Umbrella Academy, as I was shocked to find out from some people I know. I cannot get them to finish it. All right, so anyway, where I want to start this review is that as comic book adaptations become more and more popular, it's interesting to see ones like The Umbrella Academy retain the same niche quality that they have on the page. And what I mean by that is that The Umbrella Academy is not a Marvel or DC comic. It's a Dark Horse comic. And anyone who reads comics knows that the publishers are different levels and different categories. And I wouldn't say it's levels in terms of quality, but in like how far down the rabbit hole you want to go as someone who's into comic books and this type of story. And Dark Horse and Image, Dark Horse, I think, even lower. Dark Horse is pretty deep, I feel, in terms of the stories they tell and in terms of being in the rabbit hole. And so I think as a result, it has a limited appeal, especially when so faithfully adapted as something like, say, The League of Extraordinary Gentlemen. Oh, if only this creative team with this budget had that comic. It would have been amazing. But instead they have this comic, The Umbrella Academy, a comic that never quite caught on like The League of Extraordinary Gentlemen or far bigger non-Marvel and DC hits, Fables and Saga, which also have never found their way. Fables is supposed to be getting a movie or something. It's I think David Heyman of the Harry Potter franchise, that producer picked it up, but it's having a very hard time actually seeing the light of day. Because again, these don't have the same broad appeal as the Marvel and DC stories. But anyway, I think the thing that really hurt The Umbrella Academy in terms of being a comic book was that it has really bad art. I apologize to anyone who is a fan of that art, but I think for the most part, it's a real turnoff. And one of the interesting things about comics is that no matter how good the writing is, it's the visuals that really sell it. You know, because it's that cover, right? And also, you know, sometimes the Umbrella Academy would cheat and have a better cover than the art inside. But, you know, most comic book readers are pretty savvy and know what they're getting on the inside. And I think that the Umbrella Academy just has absolutely horrible art. And that is, I think, been a real roadblock for it. But business-wise, it's fortunate enough to have been dreamed up by a legit rock star, Gerard Way of My Chemical Romance, and he has the ability to put it into a lot of people's hands. And he's also a good selling point for anyone trying to pitch it. So sure enough, the Umbrella Academy, you know, beats things like Fables and Saga and maybe someone trying to bring back The League of Extraordinary Gentlemen after that crappy movie. I know some of you like it, but come on, it's nowhere near the comic. But this got there first. And it's a TV series that has been made somewhat more mainstream in both appeal and also story structure. They really, I think, have streamlined it, and I think in a very effective way, by a moderately talented TV and film writer, Jeremy Slater. I'm sorry, look at his resume. And I think that while it's while the result is pretty darn entertaining to hardcore comic book fans, I think it's probably largely Jeremy Slater's fault that it has serious pacing issues, like really bad pacing issues, that I think that most viewers won't be able to get through. They just won't be able to finish the 10 episodes, with 6 and 7 being a real hurdle to get to the spectacular ending that is 8, 9, and 10. Also, some characters work better than others. I'm gonna rank the characters, and you'll see that my least two favorites are main characters. And that's a problem. I think the casting and the way that the characters were realized was poor in some instances. And once again, also, Hollywood bets heavily on a sequel, with Slater, by the way, warning us that a potential season 2 is literally years away, as it takes 18 months to shoot and go through post-production on these things, and the show's not even greenlit or written yet. So it's crazy to end on this kind of cliffhanger and not have a second season already in the works. And I would think that a season two would be a no-brainer, especially with said cliffhanger ending. So mesmerizing, so gutsy. Unless there isn't a season two, and then it'll just be stupid. That's the problem with this kind of gamble. I mean, Sabrina got two seasons right out of the gate, but I'm sure this show is way more expensive than Sabrina. This show is so expensive, and I appreciate it as a viewer. Like, not just with the VFX and the production design, which are stellar, but the quality of the overall storytelling. And I'm talking in terms of ambition, in terms of the directing. Like, this is a streaming series that feels it's a movie. It's just it's a 10-hour movie, which I think is fabulous. Like the rave scene in episode 7, I said that was a hurdle for a lot of people, but get to these great moments. Even I struggled in a couple of moments in the middle of the season. But there were things that really would, there would be points which would kind of re-energize my interest and get me through the next couple of slow moments. And that rave scene was one of them. Just so incredibly well filmed and acted. And wow, the soundtrack must have been expensive, because such well-known popular songs ain't cheap, but here, worth every penny. One of you tweeted me that this has the best use of music since Guardians of the Galaxy, and I would actually agree with that. Very, very good soundtrack. So we'll see what the numbers are in terms of ratings, but I would bet Netflix is not only watching ratings, but also the completion rate of the show, because as I said, I think it's tough to get to. A lot of people will never see that amazing ending that demands a season two, right? I mean, I have friends, as I said, who just cannot finish it, and I've said to them, the finale is worth it, it's amazing, and their response actually is, well, then I guess I'm just not going to see it. Now let's talk characters, who, as I said, I'm going to list in the order of my favorites, and I hope you'll share your own rankings for the characters down below. So, oh, by the way, slight spoilers ahead, very slight, but I just want to give you the heads up, just in case you're one of those viewers who likes to go in totally cold. But then, as I always say, what are you doing on the internet? All right, so, it's a real Sophie's choice between Klaus and number 5 for my absolute favorite, but at the end of the day, I'm gonna have to go with Klaus, because Robert Sheehan, and this is to his credit considering the ghoulish nature of his powers, is the heart of the show. Wow, what a performance! Simultaneously hilarious and touching, his performance works on so many different levels and is so complex all of the time, by the way. It's not like he has a couple of great moments peppered throughout the show. This guy's magic every time he's on screen. I would say that if the Umbrella Academy's viewership doesn't support the same level of budget going forward for a team show, I'd be down for a Klaus spinoff. I really like what Robert Sheehan does with the character that much. Also, he has like a romance that I think is so wonderfully handled and is so inventive. But again, it's grounded in Robert Sheehan's emotional performance. It's beautiful. So he's my number one. I like talking about them as my numbers, of course, because the characters have numbers for their names. But this makes, of course, number 5 my number 2. Channeling a young David Krumholtz, Aidan Gallagher is impressively convincing as an older man trapped in a boy's body. I mean, it's a little over the top, but it works kind of like in a film noir way. And again, Aidan Gallagher really sells that. His sharp delivery and his sharp features bring a lot of energy to the show. He also has a wonderful self-confidence, which of course is integral to the type of character he's playing. Plus, he and the VFX team, because it's a collaborative effort, but they do a wonderful job selling his teleportation and time travel powers. It was a joy to watch him even make the smallest of leaps. Then I'd have to deviate from the Umbrella Academy, and my next favorite characters would have to be Hazel and Cha-Cha. I really liked this duo. Now, Mary J. Blige hasn't done a ton of acting throughout her career. She's primarily, of course, known as a singer. And her biggest gig yet, though, was for Netflix, also for Netflix recently, for Mudbound, which, of course, she got a lot of recognition for, deservedly so. But it was a smaller, less flashy part than this. So this is a fabulous opportunity that the streamer gives her once again, and once again she nails it, really rising to the challenge, and I feel she is the best female character. As for Hazel, it was bothering me throughout the first couple of episodes, where do I know that voice? It's so distinct. At first I was thinking animation voiceover, so I looked it up, and he's from Mindhunter. He played one of the main serial killers on that show, also from Netflix. And it's interesting to see Netflix start to be faithful to some talent to keep them in-house from project to project, and these two actors are excellent choices for such loyalty. As for Hazel's romance with Agnes, it was very well written and acted, but I just didn't sense any chemistry between the two of them to sell the Harold and Maude relationship. They did make me want a donut, though. If you're going to watch this show, you haven't watched it yet, do yourself a favor and get a box of donuts to watch it with, because you're going to want one. I was really upset about it. All right, so, and also because it's so hard to find such beautiful donuts in real life. These were truly movie donuts. All right, then next, Pogo and Grace. It turns out the Umbrella Academy kids were really raised by a chimp and a robot who made pretty good parents, I think, or at least they did their best. Very well intentioned. That a streaming show can deliver such a convincing creature in Pogo shows why movies are a wee bit nervous. I mean, that's just amazing movie quality VFX. And the origin of Jordan Claire Robbins' robot nanny is clever, creepy, and sweet. And that's when the show is at its best, when it hits all three of those. The show does have a bit of a Wes Anderson quality to it as well. Maybe if they turn that up a little bit more, it wouldn't be accused of being an X-Men ripoff, which, and I don't know if that's really fair, because, you know, Doom Patrol is very similar, and a lot of people are pointing out that even came out before X-Men. I think that the Umbrella Academy definitely stands on its own. All right, so next, Ellen Page as number 7. She's so low down on my list? Well, yes, and I'll explain why. Now, I will admit, she looked super cool at the end of the show. Like, wow. And we'll discuss that when I talk about season 2 in a separate video. Potentially what potentially could happen and what we would like to see happen in season 2. But I think here in season 1, as we learned more about her character and her character learned more about herself, she became more of an instrument in the story, a thing, than an actual character. And I feel part of that falls on Ellen Page, you know, that responsibility to create a more of a character. I think she fell back too much. You know, I think she pulled back too much emotionally. And I felt she slipped away. And I think that as the show progressed, we should have gone more towards her. And instead, I think we've moved further away from her than we were at the beginning, which is weird. She should have been a focal point. But we'll see what their plans are for her. They made some very interesting choices with her, which, of course, again, we'll discuss in the spoiler discussion for season 2. Then next up, Kate Walsh as the handler. I don't want to give away too much about this character, and she's very difficult to discuss because of her role, but I will say that Walsh manages to chew the scenery and look fabulous while doing it just the right amount. She and Five really do sell the film noir angles of the show. Then, Colm Feore as Sir Reginald Hargreeves. There are a lot of mysteries and there's a lot of stuff to explore about this character, and I hope they find a way to do so, because I think it's worth exploring. I mean, I think as the show goes on, you see that he actually wasn't such a bad guy. He just had trouble expressing his feelings, which a lot of people do, and I'm surprised that not one of his kids realized that. Not one of them. Oh yeah, I didn't put Ben in here. That's a spoiler, though, I guess, a pretty big spoiler. I'll just say I thought that actor did absolutely nothing with that role. Okay, so Tom Hooper as Luther, a.k.a. Number 1, I'm trying to decide if the Ben thing was too big of a spoiler. I warned you, and most of you have already watched it. Okay, so Tom Hooper as Luther, a.k.a. Number 1, he was pretty good, but I kept getting the feeling that he was a budget Alexander Skarsgård, you know? But I did think the prosthetic work on his condition was very, very impressive. I mean, he was fine. A lot of the times as we're getting lower on this list, the actors do a fine job, but they don't elevate the material as the people higher up on the list do. John Magaro as Leonard Peabody, same problem, but his role has so many twists and turns, it's very well written, that, you know, Magaro couldn't really mess it up. But again, he doesn't elevate it. And then finally, the two weakest members of the cast are unfortunately, as I said, two of the biggest, which I think does not help the show. So second to last place goes to David Castaneda as Diego. I mean, he has some nice moments with his robot mom I thought were genuinely touching. But for the most part, he just seems too network TV to me. I also never really bought him as a vigilante. I don't care what he was wearing, you know? I didn't buy it. And I didn't really buy his powers either. I never thought his powers were particularly cleverly used like everyone else's. He just seemed very bland, both as a character and as a performance. And then finally, and I'm sorry to say it, because she seems like a very nice person, and she is a talented, well, I don't know, she's a fine actress, and that's Emmy Raver Lampman as Allison Hargreeves. Her power, very interesting. I love the way the show managed to use it, because you would think, what could she do in the field? How could she really factor into the story? Fabulous the way it worked out. Now, this show on Netflix, they never really sold her as a movie star, though, which really bothered me because they clearly had the budget to do it. But, I mean, she seemed maybe like she could be like a Tiffany Haddish, like a comedian, maybe, or like a lighter actress, like a lighter comedic actress. But I think that she really, considering her powers and how Luther felt about her, I really felt she should have been more glamorous, like Halle Berry in her heyday, or even more. You know, someone like who takes your breath away like a vintage actress does. That idea of old Hollywood. I'm talking Dorothy Dandridge, Rita Moreno, or Eartha Kitt. Bigger than life. I think that would have made that character... I think that the character sometimes was annoying and, you know, she made odd choices. And I think that if she had been sexier and more glamorous in an over-the-top old Hollywood sort of way, I think that you would have been like, I don't care. She's just so mesmerizing. And that's what the character was supposed to be. So it was weird everyone was reacting that way to a performance that just wasn't. And even a costume design and hair and makeup design that just simply wasn't there. Did her roots get worse as the show went on to anyone else? I was like, how long have you guys been here? I thought it was only like a week. All right, so anyway, that's my review of The Umbrella Academy. I'm very curious to hear your thoughts down below. Stay tuned, probably maybe early tomorrow, for my thoughts on season 2. And of course, as always, you can check out some more videos right now.